Simone Weil said, every being cries out silently to be read differently. Christopher is an inmate in a high security federal prison not far from Atlanta. He's been in trouble with the law since he was 14. He didn't finish high school, had an addiction to hard drugs, and at age 21, his involvement in a string of armed robberies landed him in prison with a 32-year sentence. Right now, you've probably formed a mental image of who Christopher is, and you might be wondering why I'm opening my speech with his story. When you think about who does mathematics, do you think of Christopher? When you think about who is capable of doing mathematics and who wants to do mathematics, would you think of Christopher? And yet, he wrote me this letter after 7 years in prison, and in it, he said, I've always had a proclivity for mathematics, but being in a very early stage of youth and also living in some adverse circumstances, I never came to understand the true meaning and benefit of an education. Over the last 3 years, I have purchased and studied a multitude of books to give me a profound and concrete understanding of Algebra 1, Algebra 2, college geometry, trigonometry, Calculus 1, and Calculus 2. Christopher was writing me for help in furthering his mathematics education. So when you think of who does mathematics, do you think of Christopher? Every being silently cries out to be read differently. Simone Weil is a well-known French religious mystic, widely revered as one of the great philosophers of the 20th century. She's probably less well-known as the younger sister of André Weil, one of history's most famous number theorists. For Simone Weil, to read someone means to interpret or make a judgment about them. Every being cries out silently to be judged differently. I sometimes wonder if Simone was crying out about herself. For Simone, too, loved mathematics. She participated in mathematics, but she was always comparing herself to her brother. She writes this. At 14, I fell into one of those fits of bottomless despair that come with adolescence, and I seriously thought of dying because of the mediocrity of my natural faculties. The exceptional gifts of my brother, who had a childhood and youth comparable to those of Pascal, brought my own inferiority home to me. I did not mind having no visible successes, but what did grieve me was the idea of being excluded from that transcendent kingdom to which only the truly great have access and wherein truth abides. I prefer to die rather than live without that truth. We know Simone loved mathematics because she used mathematical examples in her philosophical writings. And you will find her in photos of Bourbaki with her brother. This is a meeting in 1937. I often wonder what her relationship to mathematics would be like if she weren't always in André's shadow. Every being cries out silently to be read differently. As MAA president, you might think that my relationship to mathematics has always been solid. I don't like the word success, but people look at me and think I'm successful, as if the true measure of mathematical achievement is the grants that I've received or the 40 papers that I've published. Like Christopher, I've had a proclivity for mathematics since youth. And this is me with hair. But I grew up in a small town in South Texas, rural town with limited opportunities. Most of my high school peers didn't even go to college. I did because my dad was a college professor, but my parents didn't know about the many mathematical opportunities that I know exist now for young kids.
My love for math deepened at the University of Texas, and I managed to get admitted to Harvard for my PhD. But I felt out of place there, since I did not come from an Ivy League school, unlike most of my peers. I did not have a full slate of graduate courses when I entered. I felt like Simone Bay, standing next to future Andre Bays, thinking that I would never be able to flourish in mathematics if I were not like them. I was told by one professor that I didn't belong in graduate school. And that forced me to consider, among other things, why I wanted to do mathematics. And in fact, that's essentially the one big question I want us to consider today. Why do you do mathematics? This is a simple question, but worth considerable reflection. Because how you answer will strongly determine who you think should be doing mathematics and how you will teach it. Why is Christopher sitting in a prison cell studying calculus, even though he won't be using it as a free man for another 25 more years? Why was Simone so captivated by transcendent mathematical truths? Why should anyone persist in doing mathematics or seeing herself as a mathematical person when others are telling her, in subtle and not so subtle ways, she doesn't belong? And in this present moment, the world is also asking what its relationship to mathematics should be. Amidst the great societal shifts wrought by the digital revolution and a shift to an information economy, we are witnessing the rapid transformation of the ways that we work and live. And yet we hear voices in the public sphere saying, high school students don't need geometry, or let's leave advanced math for the mathematicians. And some mathematicians won't admit it, but they signal the exact same thing by refusing to teach lower level math courses, or viewing the math major as a means to weed out those they don't think are fit for graduate school. Our profession is threatened by voices like this from within and without, and who are undermining how society views mathematics and mathematicians. And this view of our profession is dismal. The 2012 report from PCAST, that's the Presidential Council of Advisors in Science and Technology, pegs introductory math courses as the major obstacle in keeping students from pursuing STEM majors. We are not educating our students as we should, as well as we should, and like most injustices, this hurts those who are most vulnerable. I want us as a mathematical community to move forward in a different way. It may require us to change our view of who should be doing mathematics and how we should teach it. But this way will be no less rigorous and no less demanding of our students. Paradoxically, it will draw more people to mathematics because they will see how mathematics connects to their deepest human desires. So if you ask me why I do mathematics, I would say mathematics helps people flourish. Mathematics is for human flourishing. The well-lived life is a life of human flourishing. The ancient Greeks had a word for human flourishing, eudaimonia, which they view as the good composed of all goods, the well-lived life. There's a similar word in Hebrew, shalom, which is used as a greeting. Shalom is sometimes translated peace, but the word has a far richer context. To say shalom to someone is to wish that they would flourish and live well. And Arabic has a related word, salam. A basic question taken up by Aristotle is, how do you achieve human flourishing? What is the good life? What is the well-lived life? Aristotle would say flourishing comes from the exercise of virtue. The Greek concept of virtue is something like excellence of character that leads to excellence of conduct. So it includes more than just moral virtue. For instance, courage and excellence are also virtues. And what I hope to convince you of today is that the practice of mathematics cultivates virtues that help people flourish. The practice of mathematics cultivates virtues that help people flourish. These virtues will serve you well no matter what profession you choose. And this is the message to students. And the movement towards virtue happens through basic human desires. I'm going to talk about five basic human desires. And the first of these is play. Play is a basic human desire. Think of how babies play. Play is hard to define, but since we're mathematicians, we should at least try. We can think of a few things that categorize it, characterize it. For instance, play should be fun, otherwise it wouldn't be play. It should be voluntary. There's usually some structure. Even babies know that peekaboo follows a certain pattern. But there's also lots of freedom within that structure. That freedom leads to investigation of some sort, like, where will you appear if we play peekaboo one more time? And there's usually not any great stake in the outcome. I mean, it doesn't matter if you win or lose, right? That's the nature of play. And the investigation can often lead to some sort of surprise, like appearing in a different place in peekaboo. Of course, animals play too, but what characterizes human play is the enlarged role of the mind and of the imagination. Think of Rubik's Cube or the game Set. There's interplay between structure and freedom, and there's no great stake in the outcome. But there's an investigation that leads to delight in solving the puzzle or finding sets of matched cards. Mathematics makes the mind its playground. We play with patterns, and within the structure of certain axioms, we exercise our freedom in exploring their consequences, joyful at the truths that we find. We even have a whole area of mathematics known as recreational mathematics. Do you know a discipline that has a recreational subfield? Is there a recreational physics or a recreational philosophy? I showed a draft of this talk to a friend, and he's a chemist, and he said, jokingly, well, you know, there are actually people who do recreational chemistry. And mathematical play builds virtues that enable us to flourish in every area of our lives. For instance, math play builds hopefulness. When you sit with a puzzle long enough, you are exercising hope that you will eventually solve it. Math play builds community when you share in the delight of working on a problem with another human being. And math play builds perseverance. Just as weekly soccer practices build up the muscles that make us stronger for the next game, weekly math investigations make us more fit for the next problem, whatever that is, even if we don't solve the current problem. It's why the MAA supports competition programs like the AMC in Putnam. We help kids flourish through building hopefulness, perseverance, mathematical community. This year, you may have heard that the U.S. team that MAA trained won the International Math Olympiad the second time in a row. What you might not have heard of is that Poshan Lo, who coached our team, invited teams from other countries to train with them to prepare for the IMO. You see, our priority was community over competition. This was so impressive to the Singaporean Prime Minister that he publicly thanked Obama for this remarkable collaboration. Thanks, Obama. This was true play. Teams in friendly competition. Play is part of human flourishing. You cannot flourish without play. And if mathematics is for human flourishing, we should play up the role of play in how we teach and who we teach. Everyone can play. Everyone enjoys play. Everyone can have a meaningful experience in mathematical play. And teaching play is hard work. It's actually harder than lecturing because you have to be ready for almost anything to happen in the classroom. But it's also more fun. Play is part of what makes inquiry-based learning and other forms of active learning so effective. And there's overwhelming evidence that students learn better with active learning. This year, the Conference Board of the Mathematical Sciences, which I sit on with the other presidents of the mathematical societies, signed a statement endorsing active learning. You can find it on the CBMS website. If you want to see the evidence for active learning, we've included some background information in this statement. So teach, play. Another basic human desire is beauty. It's impossible to be a mathematician without being a poet in soul, says Sonia Kovalevska. Who among us does not enjoy beautiful things? A beautiful sunset, a sublime sonata, a profound poem, an elegant proof. Mathematicians and scientists are awed by the simplicity, regularity, and order of the laws of the universe. We call them beautiful. They feel transcendent. Why should mathematics be as powerful as it is to explain the world? This is what the Nobel Prize winner, physicist Eugene Wigner said, called the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in the natural sciences. And Einstein asked, how can it be that mathematics, being after all a product of human thought independent of experience, is so admirably adapted to the objects of reality? And mathematicians, we are not satisfied with just any proof of a theorem. We often look for the best proofs, the simplest or the most pleasing. Mathematicians have a special word for this. We say a proof is elegant. Paul Erdős often spoke of the book that God keeps, in which all the most elegant proofs of theorems are kept. Pursuing mathematics in this way cultivates the virtues of transcendence and joy. By joy, I refer to the wonder or the awe or the delight in the beauty of the created order. By transcendence, I mean the ability to embrace the mystery of it all. There's a transcendent delight to experience the beauty of mathematics, and I think we've all felt that. So if mathematics is for human flourishing, we should help others see its beauty. There are many notions of beauty. So the way you motivate mathematics through beauty must necessarily be diverse. Through art, through music, through patterns, through rigorous arguments, through the elegance of simple but profound ideas, through the wondrous applicability of these ideas to the real world in many different fields. A third basic desire is truth. Quid est veritas, or veritas, I suppose. What is truth? What is truth? Now, this is an important question, especially today. Each day seems to bring more discussion about how fake news may influence the presidential election. How do we know what is true? Some people ask me that. Well, we can't know if anything is true. Really? The quest for truth is at the heart of the scientific enterprise. I say quest because we don't do science to confirm simple declarative statements that are easily verified, like, my coffee is hot. Rather, the subject of our investigation are questions for which the answer is not so clear. Do gravity waves exist? And if so, how would we detect them? So there is a quest for truth. And we formulate a hypothesis, gravity waves exist, and we design experiments to test our hypotheses. We look for evidence. And if we find some, we ask, could there have been any other explanation? A mathematician might try to prove or disprove a statement through logical deductions from first principles. Or she might construct a mathematical model to answer the question. These approaches cultivate in us the virtue of rigorous thinking, the ability to handle ideas well, to craft clear arguments with those ideas. This virtue serves us well in every area of our life. Rigor gives us the ability to reason in the public square, as many of our community have done. Look at these opinion pieces that were authored by mathematicians recently, all written for papers. I would love to see more of us in our community exercise rigorous thinking in the writing of public of articles. We should be shaping public perceptions about mathematics and other things. And on a side note, if you want to see how math is being portrayed in the news, as Deanna mentioned, I have built an app. It's a math news aggregator called MathFeed. It's free. It's available for iPhone and iPad, and in a few weeks, Android. It links major newspapers, brings together articles about mathematics, how math is being used, as well as math blogs and publications at MAA, AMS, SIAM, and ASA. So it's a central place. I plan to encourage my students to be looking here for ideas, for projects, for seeing how math is used in the news. I would like to encourage all of our institutions to start valuing the public writing that its faculty do. More people often will read these pieces than will read any of our papers. Public writing is a scholarly activity. It involves rigorous arguments. It's subject to review processes by editors. And to borrow the NSF phrase, it has broader impact. And that impact can be measured in the digital age. Public writing should be valued by our tenure committees. And the quest for truth predisposes the heart to the value of humility. Isaac Newton said, "I do not know what I may appear to the world, but to myself I seem to have been only like a boy playing on a seashore, and diverting myself in now and then to finding a smoother pebble or a prettier shell than ordinary, whilst the great ocean of truth lay all undiscovered before me." What he's saying is what we feel often, right? The more we know, the more we realize how much we do not yet know. Mathematicians know how to accept being wrong. If a counterexample shows our conjecture was false. In fact, I'll go so far to say that counterexamples in mathematics have a special place. We celebrate them. We have counterexamples in topology and counterexamples in analysis as titles of books. Do you know any other fields with titles like these? Counterexamples in chemistry, maybe? You see, we actually like to admit when we're wrong. So when a student embraces the quest for truth, she begins to assume a certain kind of humility. She learns to handle ideas rigorously, with honesty and integrity. She values truthfulness and clarification of distinctions. This is the virtue of intellectual humility, and it's prized, and it's something we should be teaching, and it's something we should be explaining to our students that we are teaching them as a skill for their entire life. And a lack of humility, I think, has characterized the political discourse in 2016 on both sides. I wish we had more intellectual humility in the public square. When we teach mathematics, we must help our students see that we are equipping them with useful skills to handle ideas with care, to embrace humility and acknowledging when they're wrong. We have to model these virtues in our own teaching. One of the most important skills we must teach our students is to know when their arguments are wrong. How many of you have ever given a super hard question on an exam and gotten answers that look like the students just made stuff up, hoping for extra credit? How many? Yes? Yes, common experience. Well, I now explicitly say in my exams that I will give you extra credit on incomplete proofs where you acknowledge the gaps. So one of my colleagues said recently, we should really think about what we're actually assessing on these exams. And so I do this and I get much more thoughtful answers now on these exams. Mathematics builds in us the virtue of circumspection. We know the limits of our arguments, and we don't overgeneralize. I like what one of my friends, Rachel Schwell, said. She said, I think math helps me make fewer sweeping generalizations about people. For example, I wouldn't assume a person is, say, uneducated just because she is poor. Just as I can't assume a number is, say, positive because it's an integer. I can't even assume it's positive if I know it's not negative. Even if, probability-wise, it's probably positive. So I don't leap to automatic associations as much. I'm sure I can't say I never do it. A fourth basic human desire is justice. Akemi was a student of mine who did research with me as an undergraduate. She wrote an innovative paper linking game theory and phylogenetics. It was published in a highly regarded mathematical biology journal. And of all my research students, she, within the course of 10 weeks, had actually not just done the research, but wrote the paper. So she went to a top research university for her PhD. So I was surprised to learn that Akemi quit after 1 year. She told me she had many negative experiences. Her advisor was never willing to meet with her, and she faced uncomfortable experiences as a woman. She told me one example. This is what she said. At the beginning of the course, I consistently got 10 out of 10 on my homework assignments, which were all graded by the TA. One day, Jeff, a mutual friend, told me that he was hanging out with our TA, and someone asked the TA how the analysis class was doing. He went on and on about some guy named Akemi, and how perfect his homeworks were, and how clearly they were written. Jeff told him I was a girl, and the TA was shocked. Jeff told me this story because he thought it was funny that someone didn't know my sex from my name and reacted so dramatically to finding out. After that, I never remotely got close to 10 out of 10 on my assignments, and my exams were equally harsh. Most of the reasons for docked points were vague, with comments like, give more detail. I didn't feel like my understanding of the material diminished that quickly or dramatically, but I suppose it's possible that this happened or I'm just misinterpreting the situation. No, Akemi. It's not you. I hope you all agree that there's something wrong with this picture. If a certain kind of anger wells up in you, you are experiencing a telltale sign of flourishing. The desire for justice. Justice means setting things right. And justice is a powerful motivator to action. Justice is required for human flourishing. We flourish, we experience shalom, when we treat each other justly and when we are treated justly. Simone Weil realized that correcting justice must involve changing how we view others. She said this, to be ever justice, to be ever ready to admit that another person is something quite different from what we read when he is there, or when we think about him. Or rather, to read in him that he is certainly something different, perhaps something completely different from what we read in him Every being cries out silently to be read differently. Now, before we are too quick to censure Akemi's TA, we have to realize the problem of reading others differently begins with ourselves. The TA may not even have realized that he was doing this. This is the problem of what's called implicit bias. Unconscious stereotypes that subtly affect our decisions. One of the best experiences I had in MAA leadership was attending a workshop on implicit bias, in which I realized in a powerful way how I am biased, even though I try not to be. We all do it without realizing it. Numerous experiments confirm results of the following kind. When given two nearly identical resumes, except that one has a positively stereotyped name and one has a negatively stereotyped name, and choose whatever group you want, women, minority, etc., judges will rate the positively stereotyped resume higher. And this happens even if the judges come from the negatively stereotyped group. This is why good practices are important. The MAA now has a document for selection committees called Avoiding Implicit Bias. It lists a number of practices that have been shown in research to mitigate the effects of implicit bias, such as taking time to make decisions, appointing diverse select committees, generating a large candidate pool. And guess what? These are good practices, even if you don't believe bias exists. So there should be no argument for not implementing these practices that we know mitigate implicit bias. You see, we have to recognize that even if people are just, even if people have a desire to be just, a society may not be just if its structures and practices are not also just. And the only way a whole society can flourish is if the society is a just society. It's often said that the mark of a just society is how it treats its most vulnerable members. So I ask, with great humility, are we a just community? If you believe that mathematics is for human flourishing and we teach mathematics to help them flourish, you will see if you look around the room that we aren't helping all our students flourish. The demographics of the mathematical community do not look like the demographics of America. We have left whole segments out of the benefits of the flourishing available in our profession. So we have to talk about race, and that's hard. It can bring up complicated emotions, even more so with all that's taken place in the past year in our nation. In our community, we have to become comfortable talking about it, listening to each other's experiences, being willing to recognize it's there. If you want to treat someone with dignity and they're hurting, you don't ignore their pain. You ask, what are you going through? What are you going through? It's not enough to say, I don't think about race. Because in a community, how one member is doing affects the whole. And for those of us not in the dominant racial group, we don't have the luxury of saying, I don't think about race, because racial issues affect us on a daily basis. So let me encourage all of us to try to have these conversations. Be quick to listen, slow to speak, and quick to forgive each other when we say something stupid. Because that'll happen if you start having conversations, right? We'll say stuff, and we just have to have grace for each other if we make mistakes. It's better than not talking. So if we're going to start a conversation, I'll start. I grew up in Texas in a white and Latino part of the state, and I realized early that my family had different customs than my friends. My clothes were different. The food in my lunchbox was different. And these things were causing me to not fit in. I wanted to be white, not Latino, because white people got more respect. And as an Asian, I was getting picked on all the time. I had no role models for being Asian American. So I tried hard to act white, even if I couldn't look white. On the other hand, in Chinese communities, I don't fit in. I don't speak Chinese. I don't act Chinese. In Chinese restaurants, I'm viewed as white. Did you know at Chinese restaurants, at authentic Chinese restaurants, there's a special menu, a secret menu that they only give Chinese people? It has all the good stuff. Like the stuff I got in my lunchbox growing up. And I don't get that menu unless I ask for it. In fact, they often discourage me from taking it, saying, "You won't like the stuff on that menu." As mathematicians, who gets to see our secret menu? Whom do we shepherd towards taking more math courses, and whom do we discourage from looking at that menu? Don't let me sound like I'm complaining about my race. There are other ways in which I've benefited from being Asian. People expected me to be better at math and science, and I'm sure that's part of why I did, because I now know there's a whole literature on expectancy effects, that teacher expectations do affect student performance. First time I didn't feel like a minority was when I moved to California. There's so many Asian Americans there. In Texas, I would commonly get the question, "Hey, your English is so good. Where are you from?" And I'd say, "Texas." And they'd say, "No, where are you really from?" I never get that in California. And it wasn't until I moved there that I felt the freedom of that. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, I never have to answer that question here. I never have to assume that so here's what happened in Texas often, is whenever I meet a new person, I would try to impress them with my English, because I knew that they would assume that I was otherwise from China. I don't have to do that in California. These days, I'm used to being at math conferences and seeing a sea of white faces, so even I was a little bit surprised that when I was elected MAA president, a prominent blogger on race issues for Asian Americans wrote a blog post about it. His name is Angry Asian Man. Angry Asian Man. And he had heard about this somehow, I'm not sure how. But you know, in minority communities, you pay attention to things like this, right? Because it's so rare to see that kind of thing happen, right? Like my mom always called me the TV whenever there was anybody Chinese on it, you know? And Angry Asian Man looked at the photos of MAA presidents on our website, and given how many Asians he expected to be in math, noted that they were all white, except me. And so he wrote a sarcastic post entitled, "Finally, an Asian guy who's good at math." I am the first president of color of either AMS or MAA. Minorities, including Asians, are easy to overlook when you think about who would make a good leader. This may not be intentional, but when you're asked to think about who is fit for this role or that role, you often think of people who are just like the people who have been in office. And so it's very easy for implicit bias to creep in. Now I want to say I raise this discussion out of deep affection for the mathematical community. I want us to flourish. And there are ways we can do better. In 2015, I had the great pleasure of running MSRI Up, a summer research program for students. These are first-gen. One who did one work during that summer told me about her experience in an analysis course after she got back. She said, even though the class was really hard, it was more difficult to receive the humiliations of the professor. He made us feel that we were not good enough to study math, and even told us to change to another easier profession. And as a result of this and other experiences, she switched her major to engineering. Now let me be clear, there is no good reason to tell a student that they shouldn't be math. That's the student's decision. It's not your decision. You see the snapshot, but you don't see the trajectory. You can't know how she will grow and flourish in the future, but you can help her get there. Of course, we should give forthright counsel to students about skills they might need to develop further if they want to go on in mathematics. But if you see mathematics as a means to help them flourish, why wouldn't you encourage them to take more math? Another student, Oscar, told me about his experience as a math major who, unlike his peers and because of his background, did not enter college with any advanced placement credit. He says, I noticed how different my trajectory was, however, when I was in a complex analysis course. A student was presenting a solution on the board which required a bit of complicated derivation halfway through. They skipped over a number of steps, saying, I don't think I need to go through the algebra. We all test out our calculus here anyways. With the professor nodding in agreement and some students laughing. And I quietly commented that calculus was my first course here. My professor was genuinely surprised and said, wow, I didn't know that. That's interesting. And I wasn't sure whether to feel proud or embarrassed by the fact that I was not the typical math student that was successful from the beginning of a mathematical career. I felt a sense of pride in knowing that I was pursuing a math degree despite my starting point, which, by the way, was the regular starting point. It wasn't even starting from a remedial background. But I could not help but feel as though I did not belong in that classroom to begin with. The reason Oscar was in that class to begin with was actually because of the active support of another professor. Oscar said, she presented me with my first research opportunity, always encouraged me to study higher math. I was also able to confide in her about a lot of the internal struggles I had with being a minority, because as a female, she had similar experiences. And my complex analysis professor became one of my mentors as well. I think it was just an interesting moment because she didn't realize how a reaction to the situation could have hurt me. And I don't think she's necessarily at fault. It was more that her reaction piled onto the insecurities I had in regard to being a minority with a weak background in math. And once again, it wasn't a weak background, it was the standard track. I'm pleased to say that Oscar and his team from that summer just published a paper in an AMS journal, and he's now in graduate school. You hear from Oscar's story the importance of having an advocate, a faculty member who says, I see you, and I think you have a future in math. This can be especially important for underrepresented groups and women who already have so many voices telling them they can't. Can you be that advocate? And if we teach mathematics to help our students flourish, then we should not set up structures that disadvantage smart students with weaker backgrounds or make them feel out of place. And I know that can happen inadvertently among students, but we as faculty have a responsibility to shepherd the culture in our department. When I was a grad student at Harvard, they had a regular calculus class and an honors calculus class, and then on top of that, a super honors class. Math 25 and Math 55, I think they were called. And ironically, I regularly encountered students, because I was doing some tutoring then, I regularly encountered students in the honors track who felt they didn't belong in math because they didn't place into the super honors track. I had to keep reassuring them. Background is not the same as ability. I sometimes wish graduate school admissions would remember this too. Background is not the same as ability. As my friend Bill Vella says, if you want your PhD program to have more students of color, then you have to stop admitting students on the basis of background and start admitting students by their ability, like creativity, initiative. And then you have to support them. Be an advocate. They already have so many voices telling them they don't belong. I know our community wants to be just, to set things right. And if you were at the Hidden Figures panel on Thursday, you saw the turnout. There were so many people, we had to open a second room, and even then, it was standing room only. So I know our community wants to do better. So if you are looking to start some conversations with students or colleagues about some of these issues but don't know where to start, sometimes it can help to have a third party. And I'm willing to be that third party. I've written a number of articles on these topics in MAA Focus, and they're all posted on my webpage now. You could ask your students to read them and then start a discussion. I assure you, it will be time well spent. Because we are not mathematical machines. We live, we breathe, we feel, we bleed. If your students are struggling and you don't acknowledge it, why should they care about their education? Their education's just become disconnected and irrelevant. Why should anyone care about mathematics if it doesn't connect deeply to some human desire to play, to pursue beauty, to pursue truth, to fight for justice? You can be that connection. So I want to challenge each of you today. Find one student whom you know is struggling, facing some challenges, whatever they may be. Become their long-term advocate. One way to do that is to sign up to be a mentor with National Alliance, which is an organization that supports underrepresented groups who have the talent and ambition and want to go to doctoral programs in the mathematical sciences. This is directed by Phil Kutzko. I think it's out of Purdue right now. They're looking for mentors. But whether it be through this or somebody on your own campus, find somebody who's struggling. Be their advocate. I know what I'm asking you to do is hard. It takes time. But we're mathematicians. We're mathematicians. We know how to tackle hard problems. We have the perseverance to see it through. We have the humility to admit when we make mistakes and learn from them. We have the hopefulness that our labor is not in vain. We have the transcendent hope that our work will bear fruit in the flourishing of our students. Because what I'm asking you to do is something you already know is at the heart of the teacher and student relationship. And that is the supreme human desire that pushes us towards virtue. And that is love. Love is the great human desire. It's a love. To be loved is a supreme mark of human flourishing. For it serves the other desires, play, truth, everything cries out silently to be loved. Christopher, in prison, being only for medical reasons, he was looking for a connection. Someone to reach out to him in his mathematical space and say, I see you. And I share the same transcendent passion that you do. And you belong here. And when I was in the depths of despair in graduate school, struggling over many non-academic things with an advisor who said I didn't belong, already you're interviewing for jobs because I was sure I was going to quit. One professor reached out to me, became my advocate. He said, I would rather see you work with me than quit. He was my advocate. And I stand before you to ask you, find a struggling student, love them, be their advocate. I'll end this reflection by Simone Weil. And I think it gathers a lot of the strands that I've been wrestling with in my talk. After she wrestled with her own insecurity in mathematics, she saw that there was a path to virtue through her struggle, and that it could help people. She wrote this: "The love of our neighbor in all its fullness simply means being able to say to him, what are you going through? What are you going through? It is a recognition that the sufferer exists not only as a unit in a collection or a specimen in a social category labeled unfortunate, but as a man exactly like us who was one day stamped with a special mark by affliction. For this reason, it is enough, but it is indispensable to know how to look at him in a certain way. The way of looking is, first of all, attentive. The soul empties itself of all its own contents in order to receive into itself the being it is looking at, just as he is in all his truth. Only he who is capable of attention can do this. So it comes about that, paradoxical as it may seem, a Latin prose or a geometry problem, even though they are done wrong, may be of great service one day, provided we devote the right kind of effort to them. Should the occasion arise, they can one day make us better able to give someone in affliction exactly the help that is required to save them at the supreme moment of his need. For an adolescent capable of grasping this truth and generous enough to desire this fruit above all others, studies could have their fullest spiritual effect, quite apart from any religious belief. Academic work is one of those fields which contains a pearl so precious that it is worthwhile to sell all our possessions, keeping nothing for ourselves in order to be able to acquire it." You see, she had found a path through struggle to virtue. She understood that mathematics is for human flourishing. The mathematical experience cannot be separated from love, the love between friends who play with a mathematical problem, the love between teacher and student working to help each other flourish, the love of a community like the Mathematical Association of America working with each other towards a common goal through the knowledge and virtues wrought by mathematics to help everybody flourish. Thank you for the opportunity to serve you these last 2 years. Shalom, salam, grace and peace to you. May you help your students flourish. Thank you.